the face behind the shutter. Janet had no sooner hopped out of bed the next morning than she flew to the window to examine Benedict's Folly by broad daylight. In the streaming sun of a June morning, the dingy old mansion certainly bore out the truth of Marcia's mysterious description. "Gracious! I should think that you would have been interested in it from the first," she exclaimed. "Interested in what?" yawned Marcia, sleepily opening her eyes. "Benedict's Folly, of course. Let's see," went on Janet, who possessed a very practical, orderly mind. "From your story last night, it seems that there must be two people living there. But look here, how did you know, Marcia, that it was another old lady that you saw that night when the shutter blew open?" "Why, for several reasons," answered Marcia. "In the first place, the one who goes out is short and slight. The one sitting in the chair is evidently large and rather stout and different somehow, although I didn't see either of their faces. And then it wasn't the lady in the chair who closed the shutter. She evidently never moved. So it must have been someone else." "Yes, it must have been," agreed Janet, convinced. "Queer that nobody seems to know about the second one. I wonder who she is, and are there any more? Go on with your story, Marcia." "No," said Marcia. "Wait till we can be by ourselves for a long while. I don't want to be interrupted. Aunt Minerva's going out this morning, and then we'll have a chance." So later in the morning, the two girls sat by Marcia's window, each occupied with a dainty bit of embroidery, and Marcia began anew. "Well, after that rainy night, for several days, I didn't see a thing more that was interesting about the old house or the queer people who lived in it. I used to watch once in a while to see if the little old lady in black would go out again in the afternoon, as she did before, but she didn't. Then a day or two later, I did something that surprised even myself, for I hadn't the faintest intention of doing it. I had been taking a walk that afternoon, and I was just coming home, passing on the way the high brick wall of the Benedict house. It was just as I reached the closed gate that an idea popped into my head. You know they say that no visitors are ever admitted, and no rings or knocks at the gate are ever answered. Well, something suddenly prompted me to ring that bell and see what would happen. I never stopped to ask myself what I should say if someone came and inquired what I wanted. I just rang it suddenly, and I had to pull hard. The old thing was so rusty. And far away, somewhere in the house, I heard a faint tinkle. Then I got kind of panic-stricken, wondering what I'd say if anyone really did come. But I needn't have worried, for what do you suppose happened?" "Nothing," answered Janet promptly. "That's just where you're mistaken, but you'd never guess what it was. About a minute after I rung the bell, I heard light footsteps on the walk behind the gate. But instead of coming toward the gate, they were hurrying away from it. And in another minute, I heard the front door close. After that, all was quiet and nothing else happened. Then I went on home." "I know," interrupted Janet, whose quick mind had already worked out the problem, "exactly what occurred. It was Miss Benedict, who had just been about to come out on her way to do the marketing, and your ring frightened her and sent her hurrying back into the house. Isn't it all singular?" "Yes, it must have been," agreed Marcia, "and it made me more curious than ever to understand about it. And I was so annoyed at myself for ringing at all. If I hadn't, I might have seen Miss Benedict close by when she came out of the gate. It serves me right for doing such a thing anyhow. But after that, I got to watching every time I went out, thinking that I might see her on the street somewhere, especially if it was about the time that she usually did her marketing, along towards dusk. Several days passed, however, and I never did. I had a thought of watching from my window to see when she went out and then following her, but that didn't seem right somehow. It would be too much like spying on her, so I just concluded that I'd trust to chance. And luck favored me at last, one morning, about a week after I had rung her bell. It happened that night before. Eliza suddenly discovered that we were all out of oatmeal for breakfast, and I promised her I'd get some very early in the morning when I went to take my walk. You know, I have found that on these warm summer days in the city, it is much pleasanter to take a walk in the real early morning than to wait till later in the day, when it is hot and crowded, and I always used to love walking in the early morning up in Northam. Well, anyhow, I got up that day about 6. I knew that no stores near here would be open so early, and I decided to walk over towards the other side of town. It's sort of a poor section there, and the stores often open up quite early so that folks can do their marketing before they go to work. It was a beautiful, cool morning, and I was quite enjoying myself when, Jan, what do you think? I looked up, and about a half a block ahead of me was a little black figure with a market basket, hurrying along. I knew it was Miss Benedict. Can you imagine my surprise and delight? I suddenly made up my mind to keep behind her and go into the same store she did. There could surely be no harm in that. And by, I saw her turn into a little grocery shop. A minute or two after, and I walked, went to the counter, and stood right near her. There was no one in the store besides ourselves and the grocer. He looked sleepy and was yawning while he wrapped up something for her. He asked me to wait a minute, please, which, of course, I was only too delighted to do, for it gave me perfect right to stand close to my mysterious little neighbor and hear her speak. And it was right there, Janet, that I got the surprise of my life. She still wore her black veil, and it was so thick that not a bit of her face could be seen. Her dress was the most old-fashioned thing. It looked 20 years old, if not more, but I don't know what sort of voice I expected to hear. But it was nothing in the least of what I did hear. I can't exactly describe it to you, Jan, but it was the most beautiful speaking voice I have ever heard in my life. It was soft and flute-like and, oh, so appealing. It somehow went straight to my heart. It made me feel as if I wanted to take care of Miss Benedict somehow. I can't exactly explain it. Even when she was speaking of such commonplace things as butter and eggs and sugar, it was like music. Well, in a few minutes she had finished, and the grocer packed her things in her basket, and away she went. I had to stay, of course, and get my oatmeal, and I didn't see her again. But being so close to her and hearing that lovely voice had changed my whole feeling about her. At first, I had just been interested and awfully curious about the whole mysterious affair, and I'll confess, just a wee bit repelled by the account of the queer little lady and the strange way she lived. I wanted to know the explanation of the mystery, but I didn't particularly want to know her. But after that, I felt different, sort of bewitched by that beautiful voice. I wanted to help that Miss Benedict. I wanted to do something for her, or to try to make her happier, or something. I couldn't quite explain what. And I wanted, oh, so much, to see her face, and to know what she was like, and more about herself. Can you understand, Jan?
Indeed I can. But do go on. Did you ever meet her again?
No, I didn't. But I've seen and heard something else that's strange, more strange than all the rest.
Tell me quick, demanded Janet.
2 nights ago I sat here by the window. It was too hot to turn on the light, but it was very dark outside. Presently I heard footsteps in the Benedict garden. They were light, quick footsteps, and sounded exactly as if someone were running about or skipping and jumping. First I thought it must be a big dog, for it couldn't possibly have been either one of those two old ladies running and skipping that way. And then I heard a soft humming, as if someone were singing a tune half under the breath. And then, very soon after, a door opened, and a voice called out very softly, "Come in now." And, after that, all was quiet. Now, Janet McNeil, I am simply positive that there is someone else in that house beside the two old ladies. Someone who hasn't been seen yet. What do you make of it?
You must be right, replied Janet thoughtfully. It couldn't be either of them running about in the garden in the dark and humming a tune. It isn't at all what they'd likely to do.
I think that it must be someone else more human and natural somehow, and younger, too. But what on earth do they all keep so shut up for, and act as if they were afraid to be seen? It's the queerest thing I've ever heard of. You certainly have moved next door to a dark brown mystery, Marcia. For the ensuing hour, the girls embroidered steadily and discussed Benedict's folly and its inmates and all their peculiar phases. But turn and twist it as they might, they could find no answer to the riddle. After a while, Janet changed the subject.
"By the way, Marcia, how are you coming on with your violin practice? Have you begun taking lessons here yet? You know, that was one of the principal things you folks moved to the city for, so that you could study with the best teachers."
"Yes, I've begun with Professor Hardwick," said Marcia. "I've practiced quite hard lately. It's about all I've had to do. He says I've made some progress already."
"Oh, do get your violin and play some for me," begged Janet. "I am starving for some good music. I haven't heard any since you left Northam."
So Marcia obligingly went to the parlor and brought back her violin. When she had tuned it and tucked it lovingly under her chin, she sat down at the window seat and ran her bow over the strings in a shower of liquid melody. For one so young, she played astonishingly well. Janet listened, breathless, absorbed.
"Marcia, dear, you have improved," she exclaimed as her chum stopped for a moment.
"Now do play my favorite." Marcia laid her bow on the strings once more and slipped into a tender reverie of the Träumerei. But before it was finished, Janet, wide-eyed with astonishment, laid her hand on Marcia's arm.
"Look," she breathed.
Marcia followed the direction of her gaze and turned to stare out the window at the house opposite, and this is what she saw. The shutter of the window on the top floor had been pushed partially open, and a face looked out, a face with big, appealing eyes, and a frame of golden, curling hair falling all about it. Straight over at the two in the window it gazed, eager, absorbed, delighted. And then suddenly, as it detected their own interested stare, it withdrew, and the shutter was softly closed. The two girls drew a long breath and gazed at each other.
"Janet, what did I tell you? There is someone else in that house," cried Marcia.
"I guess you're right," admitted Janet, quieter, but no less excited.
"But do you realize who that third person is, Marcia Brett? It isn't an old lady. It is someone just about our own age. It's a young girl."
End of chapter 2. The Face Behind the Shutter.